Hi all, this is Vishal Singhal from Sales Chat, your host for today. So thank you for joining the webinar. So Ankita, you are ready?
Yes, Vishal.
So we have Ms. Ankita Saraf. She's a data scientist with one automotive company. So she'll be taking us through this important topic of data collection. So handing over the controls. Ankita, go ahead.
Thank you, Vishal, and good morning, everyone. I hope my screen is visible.
Yeah, please, go ahead.
Okay, so I think we can start. So first of all, great to have you all attend a session on a Sunday morning. So yeah, we'll just start off now. So today's session is all about data collection. And before we start off with the nitty-gritties of this topic, I would take a moment to introduce myself. I'm Ankita Saraf, and I'm working as a data scientist in an automotive company. So I have been in this domain for the past 3 years. And yeah, so I like to share whatever knowledge I have, because this is an upcoming technology and it's a vast domain. And I think it really helps people to understand this. So the agenda for today would be understanding the scope of data. So basically, every one of us have heard about you have come across a story about how data is changing the face of our world today. So it's very important to understand how it is changing and what role data has to play in it. Then we will get on to data collection. So basically, if we say that data is so important in today's world, then we must also have a way to collect it and make the best use of it. So how do we do that and why do we do that? That is what we'll be covering today. And then we'll be moving on to one of the most important aspects of data collection, which is known as web scraping, where you basically take off data through the internet. Whatever is available there, you can collect it in a structured format, and we'll see how we can do that. And to understand web scraping, we will look at a couple of use cases, and we'll try to understand how that is happening in the real world. So, okay, then we can start off with what is data. So data is basically just a collection of facts. It could be numbers, words, measurements, observations, etc. And it is basically translated into form which the computers can process, right? So basically, it's only another word for information. And because we are using various kinds of machines to understand the data and work on the data, because that it's not humanly possible to understand such a huge amount, so it needs to be in a form that the computers can understand. And needless to say, it is one of the most vital aspects of any research study that happens these days, right? So what is the scope of the data that we have? So by scope, what I mean is, like, if you know that you have a lot of data available somewhere on the internet or something, what is it that you can do with it, right? So there are three main scopes that data has. The first one being data collection. So you know that you have data, but you need to have it in one place, right? You need to have it in a structured format so that you can understand what the data is trying to say to you, and the computer is also able to perform its operations and analysis on the data that is there. So it needs to be in a format which the computer and the humans understand. The next part is data analysis. So once you have collected your data, you need to be able to put it to the best use, right? You would not just waste your time collecting the data. It must mean something to you. That is where data analysis comes into the picture. So when you have a lot of data in structured format, you create you create various visualizations, you try to understand the data, how one set of data is related to the other set, and how it can help you solve your various business problems is where data analysis comes into the picture. And after you have analyzed data, you have to make a decision for your business. So if you have a business problem, you are collecting data to solve that business problem. You are analyzing the data that you have collected to solve the business problem. And then based on what the data is telling you, whatever relationships you could form out of the data, based on that, you are making a decision for your organization. So this is the entire scope of the data that we have. Now, today's session is highly concentrated on the data collection part. So we'll focus on that. So what is data collection? So data collection is simply the process of gathering data from various sources based on a problem statement that you might have, right? So basically the first step in any analysis or resolution of any problem statement is that you need to be prepared with the data, right? If you falter at this stage, you fail to understand the importance of data, and then all of your data analysis and your problem solving techniques or the various machine learning or models that you apply to the data, they all will fail eventually, right? So all of your efforts will go in waste. So that is the reason that data collection is very important, and you cannot take any risks at this stage. Right, it needs to be really accurate to maintain the integrity of research. Now, why do we need to collect data, and why does it need to be really accurate? Right. So the first reason for that is you need transparent information. Right. So whether it be any domain that you are working in, whether it's insurance numbers, statistics, your sales data, or whatever. It is invaluable for your business strategy, right? So it's very critical to improve your own business practice. And for that, you need that the data is transparent, right? You do not need false data. You do not need missing data. So for the transparency of information, we need to have a really good data collection process. The second thing is that the data that you collect will help you analyze your business decisions, right? So basically, we make business decisions almost on a daily basis, right? So data that is there, that it can help you determine the effectiveness of any business decision, right? Basically, data is the only tangible way to know if the business, if the decision that you're making is right and it will help your business, or whether it will, cause your business to go in a loss in the future. So based on the data collection that you have done, you can utilize your analysis on the data to have development solutions for your organization, right? The data that you have collected can help you understand how well, say, a certain product is doing in the market, or maybe if it's a service-based company, so how your service is being taken up by the market, whether people are following you, whether there is a high demand for your product or your services, or do you need to make some alterations and improvements to your product, right? You can also understand if some of your competitors are doing better than you and why they are better than you, and what changes you need to make so that you can basically lead the market. So then you can basically, you have a good collection of data, then you can use the data to your advantage. So when I say you can use it to your advantage, it could be in any of these domains, like to say better understand your consumer, right? So most of the companies that collect consumer data, right, they only collect them to get a much better understanding of their consumers, how their consumers behave, say how they behave online versus how they behave offline. What are the overall demographics of your consumers, right? You can basically try to identify the ways in which you improve the overall customer experience. And probably using a survey, you can understand what your customers want from your company, what are their expectations, what are the products and services they are looking for, and you can better interact with them to improve your brand experience, basically. Now, once you once you interact with the consumers, you understand what the consumer wants from you, it helps you make a better marketing strategy, right? You can tweak your business to better fit their needs, right? You can improve the ways in which you communicate with the target market, or maybe you can improve the website experience, right? And then you can probably segment your consumers better, right? So in all ways, it will help you improve your business marketing strategy, right? Also, another thing is that these days, most of the consumers are looking for a personalization experience. Like, say, for example, if you have Netflix, you would definitely want suggestions from Netflix which are pertaining to your taste of genres or your taste of whatever series you're watching or movies you're watching. So that personalized experience is also highly improved if you can collect good data, if you know what data to collect, and if you have a good collection of your consumer expectations, right? So if you know what your customers are interested in, you are more likely to pitch them the products that they would probably purchase from you. Right. The next thing is competition analysis. So, like, if you know what the public likes about their brand or their product and what they dislike about your brand, you can do a good competitor analysis and improve your strategies and your products. Right. Another way that competitor analysis is done is using sentiment analysis. So you have various data pertaining to the complaints of your customers or probably their reviews online. And you can probably pick those, reviews and complaints. You can pick them up and you can perform a sentiment analysis on that. And that will help you understand your wherever you are going wrong or whatever you're doing good. So moving on, like, once we know that why data collection is so important, we can move on to how do we collect data, right? So over here, so basically, you know that data collection is important. You have a business problem statement, right? And you want to solve it somehow. But until and unless you collect the data, you do not know what to do with the data. So do you, get all the information that you probably can and then think of a use, right? This is one approach that people usually take, that whatever is available, you just collect all of it and then probably think of how you can make use of this to solve your business problem. But based on my experience, I can claim this, that this is not the right approach. You do not collect everything that you can lay your hands on and then use it. But rather, you have to plan your approach. You have to plan what data you want, how it is going to help your business problem, and then you jump into the collection of data. So how do you do this? So first thing that you need to do is you have to define the aim of your problem statement, right? Once you have a clearly defined problem statement at hand, then you choose the collection method, right? So when I say you choose the collection method, what it means is you need to understand how are you going to collect the data, like whether it's an offline way of collecting data, whether it's an online way of collecting data, whether you're going to have a survey done so that you can collect data, or maybe you have some data that is already present with your organization, maybe data related to your customers that is already present in the organization. If it is something related to the employees of the organization, that employee data is already present within the organization, right? So you need to be clear where the data is going to come from. And once you know where the data is going to come from and how much data you need to collect and how do you need to collect that, that is when you plan all your collection procedures, right? All of this together combined is the way how you go on to collect your data, right? So we will now try to understand how this works. So the first step is you define your aim, right? So by defining the aim, what we mean is the first thing that you need to do is identify your problem statement. So before you start any of the processes of data collection, you need to identify exactly what you want to achieve. Say you could probably start with, writing down your problem statement or what is the practical and scientific issue that you're trying to address, right? And how does it matter, whether it's going to improve the sales of your company, It's going to improve your customer base. It's going to help you penetrate the markets better, or it's going to help you expand your markets to different areas, right? So you need to identify the problem statement. The next step that is there is that you need to formulate your research questions, right? So once you have identified your problem statements, you need to formulate your research questions, which will basically define what exactly do you want to find out, right? And based on the research questions, you will understand what is the type of data that you want to collect, right? Now, when I say type of data, what this refers to is the first thing is qualitative data. Qualitative data is basically the data which is expressed in words and, you know, it can be categorized. And then we have quantitative data, which is the numerical data that we have. This is the data which is expressed in numbers, graphs, etc. And the usual way of analyzing these kind of data is statistics, right? We use statistical methods to basically analyze numerical or quantitative data. Now, say, for example, if you just want to measure something precisely, if your problem statement is to measure something, right? And you want to gain statistical insights about your data. So that is when you collect quantitative data. But in case your aim is to explore different ideas or understand user experience or, you know, probably understand the sentiments of people regarding your product or your services, that is when you collect qualitative kind of data. Right now, both of these kinds of data, they are further categorized. Like, for example, the qualitative data that is categorized into nominal and ordinal categories, and the quantitative data, it is categorized into interval and ratio. Okay, so we'll get into the details of what each of these means. And okay, so the first one that we are looking at is the nominal kind of data. Now, nominal data is a qualitative kind of data. It is categorical in nature, and it is simply used as an identifier to represent, say, a scale of measurement in the terms that, say, for example, you have a column which identifies the gender of your employee, so male and female. Now, these are just mere names, right? It doesn't mean that, you know, a male is at a higher version than a female or vice versa, right? These are just names. Say, for example, if you have some category which mentions the eye color of a person, right? You know that person with a brown eye color is no better than a person with blue eyes or something like that. So these are just named variables, right? Then comes the ordinal kind of data. Now, ordinal data is something where it is again a named entity, but it represents an ordered series. Like, for example, whenever we are giving a review for some website, say, right, we often see a question which says, how likely are you to recommend this particular website to your friends, right? There we have a scale from strongly agree, neutral, do not agree, and strongly disagree, right? So that would be an ordinal kind of a data where you have a named category and there is an ordered representation, right? Say a level of satisfaction with the product. So this is what is the qualitative data. Now we move on to the quantitative data. So the first category there is the interval kind of data. Now the interval data, it is basically a scale which represents quantity and has equal units, or basically a proportionate interval between the variables, but it does not have an absolute zero, right? So for example, if you have a temperature scale, right, you have a 0 degree temperature on it, but a 0 degree temperature does not necessarily mean that it has no heat at all, right? We also have a negative, we have positive, we also have a zero, but zero does not mean there is no heat. Now, that is where we have the ratio, right? Ratio is another scale of measurement, which is very similar to the interval scale. apart from the fact that it can accommodate an absolute zero, where basically an absolute zero means that something does not exist, right? Say, for example, when we say that something has a zero weight or a zero height, that means that thing does not have any height or any weight at all, right? So that is the ratio scale of measurement. Now, once you know what is the kind of data that you need to collect, we will move on to choosing the collection method, right? Now, yeah. So whatever method is best suited for your research, you need to choose that method for data collection, right? So there are multiple ways. So you could have a data source that is internal, and you could have a data source that is external. Say, for example, if you have data within your organization, that is an internal kind of data. External kind of data is the data which you collect from the outside, right? Now, external data can be two kinds, that is primary and secondary. We'll have a look at what these mean. So basically, when I say your data source could be internal or external, so internal data source would be something that is a part of your organization, say whatever sales transactions your organization is doing, whatever product related data is present in the organization. It could be your the training and the education records of the employees that you have, because most of the organizations that we have, they pay quite some attention to upskilling of the employees, right? It could be something like a market research, like before you're launching a product, you want to do a market research and you have the survey results and all of that, which are already present in internally with the organization. So that is where the internal data comes from, right? Then you have external data, say based on your problem statement. There is some data that is already present internally, but that is not sufficient to answer the business questions that you have, right? In those scenarios, you would need the help of external data, which might be available to you via various publications. So these could be, government related data or publications from, say, private companies. There is data which is available on social media. So there is a lot of data that is there these days on social media, because most of the people are there. They post, like say, for example, Twitter, you are happy or something, satisfied with the product, you post a good comment on Twitter, you post a good review on, say, Amazon or Flipkart, right? So all of that data form data of the social media, which can be extracted. And that is where we would be heading to in a while. Also, there are some official records that are present. There could be speaker engagements. There is a lot of data which is present via the news and the media, right? So all of these, they form external data. Now the external data is also categorized into primary and secondary data sources, right? So primary data sources are basically those sources where the data has been collected from firsthand experiences. Now what I mean by firsthand experience is that the data is collected for the first time. Say you're doing a survey, one person is going to each of the houses and collecting the data and everything. So that would be a primary data. So basically this data is pure. It has not been tampered, right? There has been no statistical operations that have been performed on this data, and they are in their original form, right? Say, for example, the census of India, right? That would be a primary data, right? And primary data is always more reliable and authentic because it's not published anywhere and the data is as it is, as it is supposed to be. So some of the methods of collecting primary data is like through direct personal investigation, like you go door to door and you have an in-person questionnaire or a survey that you do with each of the person, or maybe you have a survey to perform on say some product which is aimed at targeting college students. So maybe you have a surveyor who stands in front of a college and asks the students about their views, right? Nowadays, because everything is moving online, so such kinds of survey you might find online. There are a lot of surveys which you can see on say, for example, Facebook, right? So that is done. also there is investigation by observation. So, right, you observe a group of people, how they are behaving and everything, and then you have, then you collect data based on their behavior and based on their ideas and reviews, right? Also, there is something called as focus groups, where you target a particular audience and you, collect data regarding the demographics, regarding the choices and everything, right? Then moving on to the secondary data sources. Now, secondary data sources are the data that is sourced from some other place and it has originally been collected somewhere by some, say, researcher or investigator or survey data, which is available either in the published or unpublished form. So it could be either of those cases. These data sources are considered as impure because it might be that a lot of statistical operations have already been performed on them. So, like for example, whatever information is available on, say, the government portals or say some finance portal, in books or say more recently you would find a lot of data on websites like Kaggle. All of these are impure data because a lot of operations have already been performed to give them a certain form and structure, right? So these are the secondary data sources. It could be published or unpublished. And most of the published data sources, it could be international, government websites or international other websites. There could be commercial websites, there could be educational websites like Kaggle. All of these data are published forms of secondary data sources. Now, once you now at this stage, you know your problem statement, you know what kind of data you want, you know where to collect your data from, right? So your source of data is now confirmed. Now what you need to do is, once you are sure of this, you need to plan how to collect the data. So by plan, what is meant is basically you have determined the data sources, you have need to design your collection strategy. So when you determine the data sources, the things that you keep in mind is, what is the object and scope of your business problem? What is the data requirements? The data requirements, I mean, what kind of data? And you also need to keep in mind the budget that you have, right? You cannot just go on collecting all the data that is available to you. You have to have a budget so that you know how much data you need to collect to be able to solve your business problem, right? And once you have determined all the data sources and how much data you need to collect, where are you going to store them, right? That is when you need to understand your data collection design, right? What are the data types that you need to collect? What are the various collection techniques, like whether you will do a survey, whether you will be scraping data off the web, whether you will be using some API to get data from, you know, whatever website that you require, or will your work be done by, say, internal data that is available? So once you have all of that, you need to have a very strict data collection plan. And once you have your data collection plan in place, and you determine the types of data, right? So by types of data, the first kind of data is personal data, right? So personal data is anything that is specific to one person. It can possibly cover your demographics, your location, your contact details, right? So a lot of different companies collect personal data, especially on social media sites. So most of the time that you access social media, you have to put in your email address, or maybe when you're purchasing something online, you have to put in your credit card details, right? All of these are your personal data, right? Now, most of the organizations, they make use of this personal data to give you personalized experiences or personalized suggestions, right? So for example, Facebook will make use of your personal information to suggest content or videos or something like that, which you might like to see, right? It could be based on other people in your particular friend group who are watching similar content, and because that person is your friend, you might like similar content, right? So all of this personal data is used for those purposes, and also it is one of the major ways that you get targeted ads and content from you know, various companies. Some of these companies you might not even have heard of, but you can see it in your feed, right? You can see it on your Insta page, you can see it on Facebook and all of those stuff. Another kind of data is transactional data. So transactional data will be anything that requires an action on part of the user, right? So basically anything that you click on a web page, right? When you click on an ad, you make a purchase online, right? Or maybe you visit a certain web page which you know, which has an ad on another particular web page, and you click on it and you reach you know, you're redirected to a new web page. All of this will form a part of your transactional data. And pretty much every website that you visit, they collect a lot of transactional data based on how much time you have spent on the website, what are the actions you have taken, what are the particular you know, links that you have clicked on, and all those stuff, right? So this data is incredibly important for businesses because you know, it helps them optimize their operations for you know, at the highest with the highest quality results. Right, they try and identify, you know, hidden patterns and correlations, and this gives them, it basically gives them a great competitive advantage over their competitors, basically, and they can reap a lot of benefits from this, like better marketing strategies, increased revenue, and so on. Then comes web data. Now, web data is basically a collective term for anything that refers to the data that you can pull from the internet, right? Whether it be, you know, data regarding research purpose or like web scraping that we'll be talking about in some time, right? Any government published data which is available online, or say news that is available online, the cricket scores or any match scores that are available. All of this data is web data. And this has nowadays become a major way how businesses, you know, basically access information which is not even generated by them, right? So they collect all of this data, they take important business decisions based on this information that is available, right? You can generate basically a lot of leads through it, like all of these education websites. Right, like say for Coursera, Byju's, and all of this, what do they do? Like once you visit their website, they will collect data based on, you know, what all courses you checked out, and how much time did you spend, or did you fill out a form that was available, or did you put in your contact information for them to contact you? So all of this data is collected, and based on that, they generate a lot of leads, and then they target those leads, right, to generate more revenue. Right, so this is how web data is being put to a lot of use. Another kind of data is sensor data. Now, sensor data is basically produced by all the, you know, various objects, and sensor data would cover anything from, say, your smartwatch, which is measuring your heart rate, your number of steps. Then there are external sensors, which are, you know, measuring the weather. All of this sensor data is being used to optimize various processes. Like say, for example, you know, you have various sensors in your car, right, which are being regularly monitored by the companies to identify any issues that you might have with your car. And if there is any chance of an issue being found, they will, you know, notify you before the issue, you know, actually takes place. So you can take measures even before the event is happening. So that is where the sensor data helps people a lot, and it is specifically used in maintenance. So these are the you know, basic types of data that are collected. And as we know, today we'll be focusing on the web data, and we'll be looking at ways that this web data can be collected. So one of the methods that web data can be collected is web scraping. Now, web scraping is nothing more than extraction of data from the web, right? So the process is like this. So basically you have a web page and you have various scraping measures. You have various technologies which you can use to scrape data out of the web page. Now these web pages are usually in HTML form, and you have various extraction processes that you can apply, and then you can get this data in a structured format, say in an Excel file or in a text file. You can extract images, say in JPG or PNG formats, and you can also extract audio, video, and all of that, and then you can make a collection of that data which can be used for your analysis. Right, so basically the reason that web scraping is highly used in the market these days is that these technologies automatically can retrieve hundreds and millions of rows or data points from the internet. Say for example, say if you have something on Twitter, right? If a human goes on to collect data from Twitter, that person will have to read each of the tweets, collect that data. And there is a limit to a human doing that, right? But when you have an automatic intelligent bot doing that, right? That bot will go on to read millions and millions of tweets and all the information related to those tweets in a matter of seconds, right? So it becomes really easy to extract data from the internet using this web scraping technique. Now, what are the applications of web scraping? Say you can collect a lot of things from the internet, but where do you apply this? What are the uses, right? The first is obviously data science. There are a lot of data science applications where you can make use of the data, and we'll be looking at some of those. And then you have e-commerce. Like in e-commerce, say you review a product on Amazon, and there are reviews on Flipkart or whatever online website you use to purchase your product. Now, what these companies do, they collect all of these reviews, they scrape all of the reviews from there, and that helps them to analyze the consumers better, right? So that is where it comes into the picture in e-commerce. Then you have job portals where you have all of these jobs coming up, and you can extract all of that data pertaining to, say, your particular profile. Say you have particular keywords in your profile, and all of the jobs on these websites which pertain to those keywords or which match with those keywords, you can extract all of that data in a structured format, and then you can analyze the data to your purpose. Then there is marketing. So once you have your consumers, you know what your consumers want, right? That is how you can improve your marketing strategies. You know whom to target and how to target, right? So that will definitely improve your marketing strategies. Then comes finance. So there are a lot of finance reports that are available on the internet. So instead of going through all of the same, what you can do is you can basically extract keywords from them. And if they are present, you know that this document might be of use to you. And that is how you do you would apply some NLP techniques and get all the information that you want from these finance documents. Then it is used a lot in journalism. Specifically, when the elections are around the corner. So what these various political parties do is they try to analyze the sentiments of the people. So whatever you talk about or whatever you write about on these social media websites or whatever is being displayed on the news channels or the news websites. So all of that data is collected to better understand what is the sentiment of people towards a particular political party, right? And these political parties, they design their agendas and they design their speeches, all of that according to the sentiments of the people, right? So this is where web scraping is highly used, right? So now we can go on to the method that is used for web scraping. So this is a very high level web scraping method. So basically, so this picture tells you how and from where all of this web scraping takes place, right? You can have company information, social media, you know, finance and pricing websites, news sources. Now, all of these are usually HTML websites, right? And that is these search engines and all of this, and that is where from where the web scraping takes place. So the first thing that we need to have before scraping of data from the web is that you have to have a URL from where you're going to scrape the data. So basically, when you have the URL and you specify the URL from where you're going to get this data, so basically a GET request is sent to that particular URL that we are targeting, right? And all of these websites, they are HTTP sites. And once you know the URL that is to be targeted, the scraper will go, it will inspect the page. When I say inspect the page and check tags, what it means is, you know, HTML is a language which has tags, right? So the scraper, you know, if the web server processes the request and, you know, you put in your credentials over there, you have, you usually whenever you're accessing the web, you will usually have your login credentials. No? So when you have these login credentials and you put in your login credentials, and if it is found legitimate, the scraper is allowed to read the code of the web page. Right. So when you can read the code of the web page, you can extract the HTML tags that are available on that web page. And when you're able to extract the HTML based on the HTML and the various parameters that are specified on the HTML of the web page, the scraper can target the elements that you have specified in your code, and it can pick those target elements and it saves them in the format that you have specified, right? In the format that you desire. Like, say, if you are picking up, if you are extracting, say, images from a web page, it will save them in a, say, .jpg format, right? If you are, say, extracting tweets from Twitter, right? It will extract your tweets and any information that is related to the tweets, as like, say, for example, the number of likes, how many times it has been retweeted, if there are any comments on your tweet. All of this data can be extracted in the form of an Excel sheet, right? So I think I have a question over here. I'll just take a question and then we probably move on to the coding. Yeah, so the question that is here is, once you scrape the data, it often becomes tricky to get the updates on a regular basis. Is it possible to get some form of an alert or a notification as and when the content is changed in the website, as against periodically checking for updates? So for this, what I have experienced is that, you know, I have this notification thing or an alert thing is not that something I've heard of, because these websites, they change regularly, like they change their content regularly. So the only solution that is there is checking for updates regularly. You can probably schedule you can probably schedule it on a regular basis, and based on the scheduler, your content can be updated. The second part of this question is, can we identify only the delta content that is changed so that only that portion can be scraped again? So I am not aware of this delta content, because whatever I have done is, like, I have always scraped data, like the new data is scraped entirely. After the data is scraped, then you can perform, say, a delta analysis, based on which you can identify what is the data that has changed, and only those changes can be probably worked upon. Many sites use content management nowadays. Can you still get the data? So basically, this depends on various restrictions that these websites impose. Like, for example, earlier on, whenever you used to scrape, say, Twitter or Facebook, you could extract a lot of data. But now, say, for example, Twitter has a restriction that you can only extract 7 days of data, right? You cannot extract more than that, right? So this depends on the particular website that you are targeting and what access you have to that website, right? Another question is about dynamic content generation. So yes, dynamic content generation is also possible. We can scrape data real time. So if there are no more questions, I'll proceed with one of the use cases that we have over here. So this is a web scraping technology on Facebook. So over here, what we are trying to do is we are trying to extract images, right? So we visit one of the web pages. Say, for example, we visit the web page of Nike, and I'll just show that to you. So basically, so if you log on to Facebook and you select the Nike page, this is the web page that you get. And this web page, this contains all of these images that you have, right? And we want to extract these images, right? So this is the problem statement that we have at hand, and we'll see how we can perform this. So basically, what happens is, so we use Selenium for this. So Selenium is a package, which is highly used for web scraping. So what Selenium does is it basically goes on to the URL that you have specified, and it basically creates another window where you can which you can control via coding, which we'll see that in a while. And to use Selenium, you basically need to have a Chrome driver installed. If you're using Chrome, you need to have a Chrome driver installed, and I'll show you how that helps us. So basically, if you have a web page, right, you right click and you inspect the web page, this is the kind of thing that you get. Right, this is what an HTML page is, and whatever you see in this brackets is a HTML tag. Like this div is an HTML tag, right? So you have all of these tags which are defined over here, and based on these tags, we can extract data from these websites. Now, any website that you log into, you can inspect the code that is behind the designing of that website, and that is what we will make use in web scraping, right? So basically, whenever you inspect, you can also go and click on Shift Control and C, so that you can basically target each of the elements. Now, whichever element is highlighted over here, the code is automatically highlighted on the right side of the screen, right? So if I have this picture that is highlighted, all of the code pertaining to this picture will be highlighted on the right side or the coding part of the screen, right? So let me take you back to this. So basically, over here, what I have done is I have used Selenium package, and I have imported various drivers from there. So I have imported keys. I have imported timeout exception. Timeout is basically so that you can wait. Suppose you're waiting and your web page is taking too long to respond. That is when a timeout exception will take place, right? We also have a web driver wait, which helps you wait for basically a page to respond. So you wait for say 10 seconds or 30 seconds for a page to respond, and then you perform the next action on the web page, right? Then you have expected conditions. So expected conditions is used to basically identify some of the conditions that might take place. And when you reach that conditions, that is when you perform the next action, right? So these are a few import packages that we will use. And then what we do is we create a new browser session, right? So when you have Chrome driver, this particular part of code is basically used to create a new Chrome window. And when you create the new Chrome window, you wait for 30 seconds for the Chrome window to open up. You maximize the window screen, and then you wait for 10 seconds to perform any other operations, right? So when I run this command, right, a new window has opened up. The new Chrome window has opened up, and right now this shows nothing. It just shows you that the Chrome is being controlled by an automated test software, right? Now you're ready to perform any operation on this particular Chrome window. So what you do is, first, because we are trying to collect some images, I have defined an image location, and say we are only interested in three images. You can put in any number of images that you want over here. I have put in three. Now, in the next line of code, I am specifying the URL that I want to access, right? So this is facebook.com. Now, once I click on this, what will happen on this window is it will put in that URL that I specified over here, and you will be able to access this particular website. Now, because Facebook is a website which needs your email address and a password, we will specify that over here, right? We will enter a username, we will enter a password. Right. And once we have specified the email and the password, we basically need to identify where this needs to go on this particular web page. Now, how do you identify where this needs to go? So again, what you do is basically you inspect the web page, right? You get the code over here, and when you hover over this, right, you get an idea where this will be found. So over here you will basically find whatever you are looking for, right? So for example, over here, so we are trying to find an element by the ID, right? So ID would be email over here. Now if I try and find right, if you can view over here, the ID of this particular box is email, right? This is what I have specified in my code, right? Whenever we find this particular ID, that is where you put in this username that you have. Wherever you find pass, you put in the password that we have, right? And once you have done this, you click on the login. Now, all of this we are doing using code. We do not have to actually go over here, see, right? Just a second. I will just close this window and I'll do this again because I was right now, if you see, we have put in the username, we have put in the password, and we have basically logged in over here, right? Now, once you have logged in, you would want to access the particular Nike website that you are looking at. So we specify that particular website over here, and when this is executed, we'll see that over here we have the Nike website. Right? So this is the web page that we were looking at over there. Now from this web page, what we need to do is we need to extract these images. Now, to understand what you need to extract, you will first have to explore that website. And to explore that, what we do is over here, right? We inspect this website basically. So this is already there. I have right clicked and I have clicked on inspect over here. Right. Now, when we hover over these images, we see that the right part of the screen is highlighted. Say, for example, over here, what I've specified is we have to find elements which have the name underscore 2EEA, right? So how that takes place is, so over here, right? Say, for example, when we see the code, we see that when we hover on the right side of the code, that is the code part, all of these images, they are highlighted together, right? And if you see the code, each of these, right, each of these images, they have the same class, right? It is the same class that is there. Right, that is the reason we have mentioned this in the code, to identify the elements by this particular name, right? By this particular name. And when we run this, we find that there are 22 particular images that have been found which have the same class name, right? So basically what it means is there are 22 images over here. Okay, so 22 images have been found by the code. Now, once we know that there are certain number of images and we want to right, okay, so what I do is I have a few questions over here and I'll just pick those questions up and then we'll proceed with this. And if any of you have other questions related to this, you can put it in the chat window. Yeah, so the question is, can you please share this notebook so that we can do so parallelly or for later use? So yeah, I will share this notebook later on and then you can practice on this. And CAPTCHA code, so basically I haven't web scraped anything with a CAPTCHA code, but even if it is there, we have methods to basically handle that as well. Another question is, don't these websites have anti-web scraping tech? So yes, some of these websites or some of the particular pages, they do have anti-web scraping technologies in place. And that is the reason, I have taken up something which is publicly available. Like Nike webpage is a publicly available webpage. So that is the reason we are able to access it. Say, for example, if we try to access the web page of some particular person who has a restricted profile, we might not be able to do it, right? We will not have a way to access the web page of that person or the profile of that person and extract data from there, right? Also, like if, say, for example, I already mentioned Twitter earlier, it was possible to extract as much data as you wanted through Twitter, but now it is restricted to just 7 days of data. Okay, so one of the questions is, can you give a couple of examples of social media data that you would have collected in any of the projects? So basically, I had a project which I did for a competitor analysis or a product analysis, basically. So say, for example, if you are doing a product analysis, say for Zomato, right? So you can extract some data related to Zomato via the reviews that are available on Zomato itself. You can extract data for Zomato via some mention on Twitter. say, for example, when the lockdown started, right? At that point of time, all of these food delivery, food delivery companies, they made a lot of changes in, their kitchens and everything, and they came up with new ideas how to deliver food to people during the lockdown. That is when the Zomato, Swiggy, they advertised a lot, and a lot of people were talking about it on social media. There were a lot of tweets about it on social media. So at that point of time, you could probably extract tweets from, Zomato. You could extract tweets, and then you could probably do an analysis on, how are people, reacting to these changes, right? How are they, whether there are more people who are supporting Zomato, whether there are more people who are, supporting Swiggy, or if there are some opinion that is mentioned there, and a lot of people also agree to it, some changes or some improvements or something that they have done that they should not have done. So all of these data, can be analyzed via web scraping. I hope I've answered your question. And then, so then we can probably move on with the code. So we left it over here, where we have found out that we have 22 images that are available for us to use. And I had initially mentioned that I need only three of them, right? It could be any number. Now, once we know that there are 22 images, we would like to retrieve the list of these images, right? So how do you retrieve that list? So basically what I have done here is, my target is to get the high resolution images, right? I do not want the images, the small images that are coming on the screen. I want to find out the high resolution images out of these small, small images that are present on the screen, right? So what happens is basically, I'll show you over here. Okay, so this is the main page where you have all these small images. And when you click on any of those images, this is what you get. Right, and in HTML, you specify the URL of an image using src, right, or a href. Okay, So basically over here, if you have an image, you have a href which specifies the link to that particular image. So now when you click on that image, you are taken to a bigger image of that. So over here, what we are doing is we are finding an element which has an element A. Element A means an anchor, which is used to specify a new anchor. And based on that, href is a hyperlink reference, which is an attribute of a tag, right? So based on that, wherever we find this, we are basically appending that link to our list. So basically what I have done here is I'm starting with an element zero. I have created an image list, and for every particular element in that element list, what I am trying to do is I am trying to find an element wherever we have an A and a href, right? Wherever I get something with an A and an href specified after that, what I'm trying to do is I am appending whatever is mentioned in that href to this list, this image list that I have. Now, once this iterates, like I have specified the number of images, which I had taken up as three. So once this loop iterates three times, I have a list of three elements. And once I have that list of three elements, I am simply displaying those links over here, right? Now, if you see, if I click on any of these links, I will be taken to the particular picture that these link is referring to. Right, so this was one of the pictures that was there, right? So this is how I am getting access to each of the links specified on the Nike web page. Now, Once I have the links to these web pages, I need to extract the high resolution image and I need to download that image, right? I need a collection of that image, so I will download that image, right? So we start with the counter, that is one, and we have a loop which will get the image for us, right? So this is a part of the Selenium Chrome driver. So this function, what it does, it will get the particular image for you, right? Now, because we have a list with three images, it will target each of the images one by one, right? So this is the first images that we are referring to. And we wait until the URL contains a theater. So basically what happens is, so EC is basically, as I mentioned earlier, right? EC is the expected condition. So what it does is, whenever, like for example, over here you have a Nike web page, but the URL that contains the photo, right? This is another link, right? So you specify a relation between these two links, and that is what it is targeting over here. When the link name contains a word that is theater, right? That is till when this particular bot will wait. Now, once it encounters that theater, it will wait for a period of 5 seconds. And then what it will do, it will locate an element which has a class name spotlight. Now, what I mean by this is, like when you check out one of the pictures over here, right? Say if I click on this picture, and say, for example, you're checking out the code over here. So basically, because we are looking at a high resolution image, it will mention a class which is spotlight, which means that this particular picture is in the spotlight, right? So wherever you find the mention of this particular class, that is where you will extract this new URL, right? So this new URL over here, which is mentioned under source, will give you access to the high resolution image, right? So what it will do, it will identify the class name spotlight, and then it will identify where the SRC is mentioned. Under SRC, you will get the link of the high resolution image. Now, when you have the link of the high resolution image, what you do is you go to that high resolution particular URL that you have, and then you save that as image, the number of the image that you have, and in a .jpg format, right? So what this is doing is, it will retrieve the particular URL mentioned under SRC, and it will save it in the file location, right? And what it will do is, after it is done over here, it will show, after it has downloaded the particular number of images that you want, it will show that the download is complete and you have the location of all these particular URLs that we were looking into. And it also has the location of the image where it is saved, right? So if you click on any of these, you will see that you can only get the picture. So this is the main picture that has been used, or that has been linked to the Nike page, right? So this is the high resolution image that you have. And if you go to this location, you will see that all of these images have been saved. Now, because I had specified three images, these are the three images that have been stored over here. And you can find all of these images on the web page that we were looking at, right? So these are the images that have been stored. Now, once you are done with everything, you have to close the browser window. Now, this closing or quitting of the browser window will lock you out of the particular window that you were looking at. So now that particular window that has closed down, right? These were the windows that we were using otherwise, but that particular window that we had opened up using this code has closed down, and this is a very important step so that people cannot misuse your you know, login and everything that you have happening. Right. So yeah, if there are any questions related to this.
Have you finished, Ankita?
Yeah, so that is it from my end.
Okay, so audience, any last questions you may have? So this session was being recorded, so it will be made live in 2 to 3 days time over LinkedIn, or over our self-study YouTube channel, and you are most welcome to contact Ankita, and if you mention in subject that you attended this webinar, so you are contacting her, probably you will get response faster. Otherwise she is very busy with work from home and job these days. So some question is there. So you need to do inspect quite a bit.
Yes, actually, there is a lot of inspection that needs to be done. So, and it will definitely help if you have prior knowledge of HTML. Definitely.
Okay. And anybody, this is from my side. So anybody having HTML knowledge will be a good data collector, or it's not required?
Sorry, Vishal, could you please repeat the question?
So there are a lot of people who come from testing or HTML background, but they say that we have not done coding otherwise, and we would like to go into data science, but how to do all this data engineering, cleaning, collection, and all that stuff. So are you saying that HTML knowledgeable people will be able to do data collection easily, or it's not that critical?
What I think is, like, if you ask, you know, if you're using web scraping for data collection, right? So because all the web scraping methods, they need a little bit of HTML knowledge, because you need to understand, you need to find out the elements that you're trying to extract, right? But it's not necessary. Like, say, for example, if you are web scraping via an API, like we do for, say, Twitter. So Twitter has an API which we can use to extract the tweets and all of the data related to it. In that case, you might not need HTML knowledge, but if you need to do something like the example that I have shown, or say, for example, if you want to extract particular news snippets from news websites. So that is when HTML knowledge, a little bit of HTML knowledge would help. Because you need to understand the tags, like I mentioned the A tag, I mentioned href, I mentioned SRC. So if you understand what they mean and how they have been used in the designing of the web page, so that will definitely be helpful.
Okay. So any other questions, audience? So since no more questions are coming, I would like to thank Ankita as well as all audience who have attended. Sunday is generally free days. People don't even pick up the calls, and you are attending the webinar. That's very appreciative of you all. And thank you all. And I would request Ankita if she can spare more time in future for more topics. Okay. Thank you.
Definitely, Vishal. I'll try that. Thank you so much.